Good morning. I want to welcome you this morning and tell you happy Easter and hope that all of you had a wonderful Easter celebration. And I think it's true that I feel as though all of us that have been in the Gospel of Luke, hopefully it was a richer Easter celebration than ever before. I want to take a moment and welcome those of you that are visiting with us and tell you that we're so excited to have you with us. And let me remind all of the class members that, again, next week is a time to invite people to come with you. So we would urge you to please prayerfully consider doing that. I also want to mentioned to class members that if you remember 2 weeks ago, Ashley taught Luke 21, which of course was the Lord foretelling what would happen in the future as far as with the destruction of the temple and with his coming again. And I want to say that there is a sheet that we've made available. It's actually down here on the table below. And it, if you are interested, you are sure welcome to come and get one. It basically does what we encouraged you all to do when we gave you the list of end time events. We should all know what the scripture teaches. And at the same time, no, we cannot be dogmatic about the sequence of those events. But you should know what you believe and why. And this actually gives three main viewpoints that are different in how they think the sequence is. And it tells some proponents of each view that I think you'll find interesting. So please take advantage of that if you so desire. And then I'd love to ask all of you if you would take your outline and turn on the back side. And there is a hymn that is relatively new called Come Behold the Wondrous Mystery. We have sung it once this year already, but if you would take that and let's stand and let's sing it together. Come Behold the Wondrous Mystery. Thank you. If you'd be seated. Thank you, Joy. I hope you always listen to the words of a hymn as you sing it, and in particular, that second stanza when it says, come behold the wondrous mystery. He, the perfect Son of Man, in his living, in his suffering, never trace nor stain of sin. And I feel as though that is something that we will clearly see in our lesson this morning. And as you've already realized, we're combining two lessons. And so in view of doing that, I'm staying only in the Gospel of Luke this morning for the most part. We'll go to Jeremiah briefly. But I urge you on your own to go back, and especially the passages in John that we referenced in our questions, they help take us even deeper as really John 14, 15, 16, and 17, Jesus was teaching the disciples at this same time. So let us bow for a word of prayer as we begin. Father, this morning as we would start, we stop in order to come before you. And Lord, I pray that you would still our every heart, that you would give us concentration, that we could be attentive to you and your word this morning. And Lord, I pray that we might see the perfect life that you lived and that you gave. And Lord, that we might act upon it as you call us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. If you turn with me in your Bibles to Luke 22, and we will look at the perfect life of the Lord Jesus in verses 1 through 46. We will see his love for his own in verses 1 through 38, as we'll note his preparation and then his provision and then his patience as he dealt with his own. And then secondly, and briefly, we will look at his love for his Father in the Garden of Gethsemane, verses 39 through 46. And I'll go on and tell you, we'll probably go back to that garden next week as we begin our lesson next week. But if as we begin, if we would stop and think about the context of where this is, and that if you'd remember with me that, again, 2 weeks ago when Ashley taught, what was it, except it's often been referenced as Jesus's Mount Olivet discourse when he talked about the future and the prophetic events that were yet to come, the destruction of the temple and even his glorious return. And every day, Jesus would go in and teach in the temple, on the temple site, and then at night, he would withdraw to Mount Olivet. Early in the morning, he would go right back into the temple. And Luke records, as well as the other gospel writers, many were coming to hear Jesus, even early in the morning. And that's part of the context as we begin in chapter 22 with verses 1 through 6, also dealing with context. Verse 1 tells us, now the Feast of Unleavened Bread drew near, which is called the Passover. And let me just say that initially the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread were two different but successive festivals that the Jews observed. But by New Testament times, the names were interchangeably used, indicating the one feast. And this feast was to commemorate God's great deliverance of the children of Israel when they were in bondage in Egypt. The book of Exodus tells us that God commanded his people while they were still enslaved to take a male lamb without blemish and to kill it and to take the blood and to dip hyssop in the blood and to smear the blood of that lamb over their doorpost. And then what they were to do was to take that lamb and to cook it completely and to partake of it that night and to be ready in a moment to leave when called upon. And of course, only those homes were spared death when the angel of death went over that had blood over the covering of the door. Verse 2 tells us, and the chief priests and the scribes were seeking how to put Jesus to death, for they feared the people. So we see their urgency, and at the same time, they thought, this Jesus, we've got to stop him. We must do it, else he'll be unstoppable. And the one reference from Matthew chapter 26 said the one thing they were certain on is they did not want that to happen during the Feast of Passover, which again, we'll note the sovereign God overruled. Verse 3, it said, then Satan entered into Judas, called Iscariot, who was of the number of the 12. Now, this does not suggest demon possession, but rather influence, in that Judas's heart was under the devil's influence. And with that, we need to note that Judas could not have entered unless Judas was willing and that Judas opened the door. And we'll look again at the accountability of Judas in just a few minutes. But verses 4 through 6, Judas with the chief priests were conspiring all the while to get rid of Jesus. And that's the context of our lesson. We note Jesus' preparation for his disciples in verses 7 through 13. Verse 7, it says, "Then came the day of unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed." And we note the word "had" there because God had commanded that the lamb be sacrificed on Passover. And at the same time, "had" also in regard to the Son of God because it was God's will for him to be sacrificed. At the same time, Jerusalem at this time was swollen with people because of Passover. It was the typical duty of the priest that they would begin by burning all of the leaven that had been collected the night before. And by 3 o'clock in the afternoon every day, the ritual slaughterings began, where worshipers would come and bring their male lambs without blemish or the offering that they brought. And the priest would, again, the animal would be killed, and the priest would take the blood and pour it at the base of the altar. And as the offerer left the temple, the slain lamb and its skin would be draped around the shoulder, over his shoulder. And then he would take the lamb home, and the lamb would be roasted and served that night in their home or the room. And the company would be dressed in festive white, and they would recline as they ate, remembering that they were no longer in slavery or in bondage. Luke was very precise about Jesus' preparations for his own in verses 8 through 12. He sent specifically Peter and John to go and prepare the meal. And let me just say, it's almost as though secretively he calls them aside and tells them. And undoubtedly, because Jesus was well aware of Judas's intention to betray him, and how Judas and the chief priests would have delighted to know where the upper room was and to have gone there in the privacy of that room and arrested Jesus. And just think if that had happened, the Lord's Supper would have never been instituted or given to the church. So quietly, Jesus called Peter and John, and he gave them a very vivid sign. Women at that time were usually the ones that carried water jars, and Jesus told Peter and John, again, to look for the man carrying the water jar and to follow him in the house he enters. Verse 11, "Tell the master of the house, the teacher says to you, 'Where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' And he will show you a large upper room, furnished. Prepare it there." And what did they do? But Peter and John went and found it exactly as Jesus had told them, and they prepared for Passover. You know, again, I don't believe we can really completely understand how amazing it is that here is Jesus preparing for his own disciples in view of what he knew about his own impending death. And his concern was for his disciples as he sends Peter and John and prepares for them, and the upper room is prepared. You know, do you and do I know what it's like to have Jesus care for us? I remember several months ago, we had a visitor that came. He had called us and asked if he could come and stay for us, and we all think so much of him. And so with delight, I got his room ready. I changed his sheets, and when somebody's really special, I iron the tops of them anyway, but I ironed the sheets and put them on the bed, and I put some flowers in the room, and I put some chocolate-covered almonds by the bed and prepared something that I knew they loved to eat for dinner that night. And he was so kind. At the end of the evening, he looked and he said, "I've never felt so loved." And I thought about the preparations that Jesus went to care for his disciples. It just underscores his love for them. You know, when is the last time, even at the end of a day, that you took the time to look back and to thank the Lord for the obvious signs that indicated his care in going before you and me? He loves his own, and those preparations show it. In verses 14 through 23, we see his provision. Verse 14, and when the hour had come, and again, this is the critical moment really in salvation history when Jesus Christ would really be revealed as the Savior. He reclined at the table and the apostles with him. In verse 14, and he said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. And again, Jesus' intense longing to spend this special time with his own. Again, I thought about this week as I studied. He longed to be with them, to teach them, to tell them the most wonderful truths that I really believe have ever been revealed. And he longed to at this meal, and this meal would be transformed forever. It basically would become an acted parable of his life and his death. In verse 16, he says, for I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And again, what is this except the future messianic banquet? I wish in the margin of your Bible you would put down Revelation 19, because more details are given about that ultimate time of communion at the marriage feast of the Lamb. And in verse 17, Jesus took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to his disciples. In verse 18, again, he says, for I tell you that from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And what does that mean? But ultimately referring to the time when Jesus Christ will come back and the kingdom of God physically will be established and all of his that believe in him will be with him. Jesus's heart, in one sense, traveled beyond the sorrow of his death on the cross to his reunion in lavish, festal joy forever with those that belong to him, to that time of communion. In one sense, the writer in Hebrews references this in Hebrews 12, verse 2, when it says, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame. And it seems as though even as Jesus talked with them, just understanding he would not commune with them and partake again until the kingdom of God would come was well in his mind. Always when we celebrate communion, we should have in mind that ultimate time of communion, the marriage feast of the Lamb, which forever we will have and participate with the Lord. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 26, Paul writes, for whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And again, Jesus is coming, and the time when God's kingdom will be fulfilled should again always be in our thoughts when we partake of communion. Verse 19, it says, and he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And again, as Jesus took that bread figuratively, he again is teaching them, just as he figuratively had said, I am the good shepherd, or I am the door. Again, he takes that bread, and the bread symbolized his body, his life that was given for them, given for you, given for me. The vicarious gift of himself on the cross for our sins. And he says, do this in remembrance of me. And you think, why would Jesus tell them and tell us to do this in remembrance of him? And it is because, again, we're called to study and to remember. We are so tragically prone to forget what Jesus Christ has really done. He says, take and eat, that this is his body which he has given. And again, in verses 19 and 20, it seems as though time passes between those two verses. In verse 20, it says, and likewise, meaning in the same way, the cup after they had eaten, this cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. Here, Jesus is deliberately contrasting his atoning work with his own blood to the old covenant with its ocean of blood. And if you'll bear with me for just a moment. In the Old Testament, in the book of Exodus, the Ten Commandments were given in Exodus 19 and 20. And then the book of the covenant was read from Exodus 20, verse 18, through Exodus 23, verse 33. And then what is it? Except the Lord called for the children of Israel to obey the old covenant. Two parties were involved, God on one side and the people on the other. And at the end of the reading of the book of the covenant, the people, the children of Israel, said, "We will obey it. Everything the Lord has said, we will do." And it never happened. Disobedience was what they did. And yet in Exodus, everything that was of significance was doused with blood. Moses put blood on the altar, sprinkled blood on the people, sprinkled blood on the scrolls. And it was all symbolic. And the old covenant was really launched in a sea of blood. And you think, why all that blood? And we really need to be mindful of the reasons. One was to emphasize the seriousness of sin. You know, we live in a culture right now that's often oblivious to sin or says sin doesn't really matter or there are no consequences. The sprinkling of the blood in the Old Testament was to remind all that sin is a serious matter. And the second reason for the dousing of blood was to teach that the payment for sin is death. The weakness of the Old Covenant is part dependent on human beings to keep, and only disobedience came. God gave his law and called the people to obey. And the people said, "We will obey," and only disobedience. Every single one disobeyed. But then we come and we listen to the words of the Lord Jesus. When he says in that verse 20, "And likewise the cup after they had eaten, this cup is poured out for you in the new covenant of my blood." The idea of the new covenant should have struck a chord with the disciples in that it was not really new in the sense of 600 years earlier. God, through the prophet Jeremiah, had talked about the new covenant that would come. If you would hold your place in Luke and turn with me back to Jeremiah chapter 31. And let me just say that as you go back to Jeremiah 31, the new covenant is completely different than the old covenant. The old covenant had two parties, God and the people disobeyed. In the new covenant, God does it all. He does all of it. And we look and we see that again, the superior work that Jesus is talking about, that he offers, brims with the fulfillment of what is in Jeremiah. Look with me at Jeremiah 31, verse 31. It says, "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord." And I love it. It's almost like Almighty God is on tiptoe. He cannot wait for the new covenant to come. "When I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, my covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, declares the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each one teach his neighbor and each his brother, saying, 'Know the Lord,' for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more." Now listen carefully to the superior work of the new covenant that Jesus Christ ushers in. The first characteristic you see in verse 33, a superior inwardness. He says, "I will put my law within them and I will write it on their hearts." The problem with the old covenant is it was external. The wonderful characteristic of the new covenant, it's internal. Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26, and I'd urge you to jot that reference down. Ezekiel 36, 26, He says, and I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you. And that again is descriptive of this superior inwardness that again, when a person comes to faith in Jesus Christ, what is it but they receive a new heart with the Holy Spirit within that heart. I love the fact this past week as I was studying, I came across a very accurate account. In 1967, the whole medical world was astounded when the first heart transplant occurred in South Africa. Dr. Christian Brainerd, if many of you perhaps remember, but anyway, it was an astounding thing. The patient was in really duress and expected to die, and he performed open heart surgery for the first time, and it was amazing. He had known he was going to die, and yet here he was, almost with new life because of the heart that had been put within him. And he was ecstatic in experiencing that which had happened. I want to ask you the simple question, is spiritually, have you had a heart transplant? Have you had a new heart put within you? That is the first aspect that's described in this new covenant through Jesus Christ. The second characteristic is the superior relationship, also in verse 33. And he says, I will be their God, and they shall be my people. The old covenant was only fulfilled in some. The new covenant was perfectly fulfilled in all who would partake of the new covenant. And they would become intimate with God. Believers would become God's possession, and God would become theirs. I am His, and He is mine. The intimacy with God that comes through the new covenant. The third characteristic is the superior knowledge in verse 34. No longer shall each one teach his neighbor and each his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. And let me just say, the old covenant was entered into by the nation of Israel, including many that did not really know God personally. The new covenant is entered into by those who come by faith in Jesus Christ. And the knowledge that He gives them is eternal life. In John 17, verse 3, Jesus describes it. He says, Now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. So all partakers of the new covenant know God. They have eternal life. They know God the Father and God the Son. And then the fourth characteristic of the new covenant is they have superior forgiveness in verse 34. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. And let me just point out the obvious. Under the old covenant, all a person could do would be to bring a male animal and have it sacrificed and the blood be shed, and that temporarily covered their sins and ultimately pointed to the sacrifice that would come. Under the new covenant, what happened? Except God made provision for sins through the death of His Son to be completely forgiven forever. All right, listen carefully. One question that's often put in the question basket is, how can God really forget our sins? When he says and promises, your sins are forgotten. And listen carefully. God cannot forget unless He wills to do so. And when sins are not remembered, it is because His grace has determined to forgive them. It is never in spite of His holiness. It is always in harmony with His holiness. So the way that God forgives and doesn't remember our sins is because our sins have been dealt with in full. His holiness has been satisfied, and by grace, we are forgiven. The new covenant brings total forgiveness. And it's really amazing when we think about, as Luke describes, here in the upper room, the disciples reclining, candles flickering, seeing and hearing the Savior of the world unlock the mystery of salvation. Through His body and blood, the new covenant is made available. The new covenant of his blood. And really, what is Jesus saying? It is my life for yours. And we see his provision. His salvation, it is superior. It is eternal. And in verses 21 through 23, Jesus revealed that the betrayer was at the table with him, fulfilling even Psalm 41. And we see the sovereignty of God in this as well, and that it was clearly God's plan for Jesus to die. And at the same time, Judas was fully accountable. Look with me at verse 22 in Luke 22. It says, "For the Son of Man goes as it has been determined." In other words, it was God's sovereign plan. "But woe to that man by whom he is betrayed." Why? Because he is accountable for the choices that he made. And again, the sovereignty of God never negates the accountability of man, as it did not with Judas. And then verse 23, the disciples began questioning, who might this one be? They had no idea. But I want to ask you, before we continue on, do you see the love of Jesus Christ in his provision for his own? He was willing to give his body, his life, to give his blood, to shed his blood in order that salvation might belong to the person that would believe in him. You know, I might ask you the characteristics of that new covenant. Are they yours? Do you have a new heart? Do you have an intimate relationship with Almighty God? Do you have the knowledge that is really eternal life? Do you know this morning you have complete forgiveness because of what Jesus Christ has done? You know, I want to say this. We can, and I'm as guilty as anybody in this room, of getting so preoccupied and caught up in all kinds of things, but there is no more important a question to answer than what I just asked you. Have you ever received the provision that only Jesus Christ can give you in salvation? You know, yesterday as I was preparing, my phone rang and I answered. It was Joe, and he had made plans last week to meet a friend of his for lunch this week, and his friend had been out of town in the mountains, had come back, left his family in the mountains to come back to get a few things done, had started feeling terrible after simply taking the trash back, had gotten in the car, had headed to the hospital, and died before he could ever get out of the parking lot in the hospital. You know, let me just tell you what we all need to understand. We're not guaranteed another day or another moment. What have you and what have I done with really the provision that Jesus Christ explained to his disciples and explains to us is ours through faith in him, believing that he came and that he lived and he willingly died to take your place and my place, to pay the penalty for our sins, in order that we might be completely forgiven by the Holy God. You know, let me just say, the love of Jesus Christ for his own is so astounding when we contemplate his provision for them as his provision for us. But let me just say, as we continue in verses 24 through 38, we see the patience of the Lord Jesus. And again, let me make you mindful for what it seems like the disciples were oblivious. It seems as though they were oblivious to what was imminent in the life of Jesus, his death. And at the same time, what did they do? But how they get in verse 23 from wondering about which one it was that was going to betray them? You know, obviously Jesus had shown and indicated nothing that it was Judas. He loved his 12 disciples. They had no idea, and they ask, and then they get in verses 24 through 30 and move on. Well, which one of us is the greatest? If we can't figure out who the betrayer is, which one of us is really the greatest? And it's an amazing thing. When Jesus describes the idea of greatness in the world's eyes in verses 25, but then he goes to verse 26, the radical principle in his kingdom that the greatest is really the one that serves. And John's gospel particularly tells us that he took aside his garment and then washed the feet of his disciples. So again, in the midst of all the dissension, you see Jesus persevering in his love for his disciples. And then you think about verses 31 through 34, and basically what was Peter except he was quick to speak up as he often was, and yet basically Peter was saying, Lord, I can do it. I can follow you. I will follow you even to prison or to death. And that's where Jesus then tells him, Peter, Satan wants to sift you like wheat, but I have prayed for you that your faith will not fail. And then Peter's own self-deception, thinking that he was good enough himself, he would never do it. And then Jesus specifically says, before the cock crows, Peter, you will deny me three times. You know, how many times did Peter deceive himself? How many times do you and I deceive ourselves, thinking we're really better than we really are? We have no idea how desperate we are for Jesus Christ. And then their dullness in verses 35 through 38, as though they didn't really understand when Jesus called on them to remember how he had provided for them in the past when they took no money sack or no sword. But now, because times were going to be dangerous, he called on them to take these things in preparation. And then they again were dull and confused and say, well, look at these two swords. And it's as though Jesus says, that's enough of that kind of talk. Just stop. But as he patiently dealt with his own. You know, I don't know about you all, but it encouraged me so much that here the disciples were, dissension in their midst, not loving one another as they should have been, deceiving themselves, thinking they were better than they were, confused and dull and not understanding. And Jesus was patient with them because he loved them. And he hasn't changed. You know, do you really see and do I really see the love of the Lord for his own? He prepared for them because he loved them. He provided for them because he loved them. He was patient with them because he loved them, and he has not changed. And let me just say the obvious too, when we struggle with those around us, might we follow his example in showing us how to love one another as he did. But as we come to verses 39 through 46, do we really see the core, at the core of Jesus' life was his love for his Father? Verse 39, it says, and he came out and went as was his custom, in that he was in the habit of withdrawing for prayer. And he went to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. In verses 40 through 42, Jesus urged them to pray. And he went a stone's distance away and knelt and prayed. And I'm so thankful that they could still hear and that they heard him say, verse 42, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me, but not my will, but yours be done. Let me just mention a few things about this verse as we close. This cup, it meant God's will for Jesus. This cup symbolized the suffering and the anger of Almighty God for sin. God's wrath for the sins of the world were in the cup that was before Jesus. And we really need to ask the Lord to help us comprehend and understand the meaning of this cup. And yet, even as we barely begin to understand what this cup meant for Jesus Christ, let me just say that we see and recognize the humanity of Jesus as he prayed. Yes, Jesus is fully God, the second person of the Trinity, but he's fully human. And in asking God and asking his Father, if you are willing, remove this cup. Lord, if there is any other way that I can be in your will but not face this cup. And you think, well, what was it about this cup? And again, we need to remember what we've just been reading and studying all year in the Gospel of Luke. Jesus Christ knew no sin. Sin might bother you and me. We think about pornographers, or we think about adulterers, we think about this. But just imagine if you or I had never sinned, how repulsed by sin we would be. Jesus knew no sin. He knew that his Father is holy and that God has wrath for sin. And we can hardly imagine how horrible the wrath of the holy God is for sin. Jesus knew it. And it was the wrath of God for all sin that was in this cup that was to be poured out. Three times, as we combine the gospel accounts, did Jesus come back and find his disciples sound asleep. And he goes back and prays. You know, let me just say, all the while, not once did Jesus say, "Don't you know what I'm about to face? Don't you know what is before me?" As he loved his own, but called them to pray, and three times they were sound asleep. Luke records unique details. Verse 43, there appeared an angel from heaven to strengthen him as the Father heard his prayer. In verse 44, Jesus sweat drops of blood as he prayed, as he persevered in prayer, communing with his Father. You know, many that have studied carefully this chapter have said, and I think it could well be true, that actually this is where the battle for your salvation and mine was won. The absolute, complete surrender of Jesus Christ to take the cup that his Father would give him. Was there any other way that salvation could be accomplished, that God's will could be carried out? And the answer to his own son was no, this is the cup that you must take. And Jesus, in complete surrender, trusted his heavenly Father. This cup, what would it mean? But the sinless Jesus would take the cup of our sin, being willing to become the worst of the guilt and the shame, the worst of the murderers, the worst of the slanderers, the worst of the pornographers, the worst of the abortionists, the worst of all. And Jesus, though repulsed, took it because he loved his Father. And he longed at any and all costs to bring glory to his Father that he loved. How did he do it? He persevered through prayer. If you're like I am, when I've read these verses, I've had to just cry out and say, "Oh Lord, teach me how to pray. I don't know how to pray." But through prayer is how we know Almighty God. And Jesus, knowing his Father, knew that even that cup was what he willingly would choose to take on our behalf. Let me just say the obvious here. When we read these verses and we contemplate and meditate upon them, how obviously it's blasphemous to think that sin doesn't matter. How obvious it's blasphemous to think there could be many ways to God. How obviously blasphemous to think that God doesn't care. And again, we need to stop and to think again what these verses tell us, that Jesus Christ willingly took the cup because it was the will of the Father. One last thing is we need to know that this was the underwriting point and purpose of all that Jesus did, to love his Father and to bring glory to him. Many times when we even refer to the gospel of Jesus Christ, if you're saved, there are times where people will say, "Oh, well, the gospel is about me, and the gospel is about my salvation, and the gospel is that Jesus saved me and he loves me." And yes, that is true, but that is really incomplete, in that the ultimate purpose that the gospel is available is because Jesus Christ longed to love and bring glory to God the Father. And God the Father is most glorified in making salvation possible for filthy sinners to be saved and to be brought into a relationship with him through his son Jesus. You know, the perfect life of Jesus is before us in these verses. He perfectly loved his own. His preparations for them, his provision for them, and given of his own life to take their place in order for salvation to be theirs. And then in his patience with them, as they still didn't understand and were so dull and argued and fussed and whatnot and deceived themselves, Jesus hasn't changed, and he still loves his own. And I would ask you the simple question, have you ever realized that if Jesus Christ did not live the perfect life, none of us would be bound except for one place, and that is to hell forever? The perfect life of Jesus Christ, what does it mean? That there is one provision for salvation, and it is through faith in him. And the person that believes in Jesus, that he willingly gave his life to die in her place and to suffer for her sins, what happens? But she is ushered into the new covenant through his body and his blood. And what does that mean? Except that means she's given a new heart. That means that the Spirit of God is put within her. That means that she knows God and has eternal life and has complete forgiveness. Is that provision yours today? And if not, I might urge you, might today be the day that you answer and surrender all to the Lord Jesus. And then might we thank the Lord that he's not just our Savior, but he lived life the way we should live it. The perfect life, how can we love those around us? By looking at the example of the Lord Jesus in loving his own. And in so doing, how he loved his Father in absolute surrender. And you think, well, Sarah, how can I do it? Again, he doesn't just call us to follow him. He enables us in that the new heart that he's given, his very Spirit indwells that we depend upon. The perfect life of Jesus, his love for his own, and his love for his Father. Let us bow in prayer. Father, how we thank you so much for your word. And that, Lord, you not only have desired to speak, but, Father, you have desired to make salvation possible for us at the greatest of cost to yourself. Father, we praise you that your word is true, that you so love the world that you sent your only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. I pray, Lord, if there is even one here today who has never looked to you, Lord Jesus, and understood that it's through your body and through the shedding of your blood that salvation is possible, I pray that, Lord, she might surrender her all to you today and receive you as Savior and Lord. And then, Father, I pray that you would enable each one of us to really meditate on the perfect life that you lived, Lord Jesus, that we might be serious about following you and might stop refusing to love those around us, but would follow your example. And that, Lord, we might ultimately especially love you, God the Father, and be in absolute surrender to you as you, Lord Jesus, have shown us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.